Good to see everyone back tonight. Hope you've had a good afternoon. You've enjoyed whatever it was you were planning to do and did. We're glad that you're back here this evening. I didn't say anything this morning. Should have probably overlooked it, but I understand that the women had a very good ladies' day yesterday. I think they had somewhere around 85 ladies in attendance from different congregations, and I'm not going to try to name the ladies who worked on that because I don't know all of them, but there were a bunch of women involved, and I know they've been working on that for several months, and it turned out real well. So we thank all of those who worked on it and who participated and showed up. In Acts chapter 17, where Jeremy just read our scripture for this evening, in that chapter we read of Paul's second missionary journey, that we call it. As the chapter opens, he is in Macedonia. He had a successful work up in that northern region of Greece. He had a successful work in Philippi, had a successful work in Thessalonica, and also one in Berea. In all three of those towns, he left a congregation of disciples behind, but in all three of those towns, he left due to increasingly violent opposition. In other words, he was run out of town each time. In verse 16, he then arrived in Athens. Reading verses 13 through 16, just to give us a little bit of the background and how this sets up. But when the Jews from Thessalonica learned that the word of God was preached by Paul at Berea, they came there also and stirred up the crowds. Then immediately the brethren sent Paul away to go to the sea, but both Silas and Timothy remained there. So those who conducted Paul brought him to Athens, and receiving a command for Silas and Timothy to come to him with all speed, they departed. Now, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him when he saw that the city was given over to idols. It's not really clear if Paul was in Athens because he had decided to go to Athens and work in Athens and preach in Athens, or if he simply traveled through Athens on his way from Berea to Corinth, and that Corinth was really where he was trying to get to. The way I read it, personally, it sounds more like this was just an incidental stop while he waited for Silas and Timothy to catch up to him. But in either case, if he was going to be there, he was going to use the opportunity to share the gospel and to preach the gospel in that town. As was his custom, wherever there was a Jewish population, he first made contact with the local synagogue. But it was his contact with the pagans of the marketplace that receives most of Luke's attention here in Acts chapter 17. Going on to verse 17, therefore he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and with the Gentile worshipers and in the marketplace daily with those who happened to be there. Paul then engaged Epicurean and Stoic philosophers in discussions about God and the meaning of life. By the first century, the golden age of Athens and classical Greek had passed. Athens was no longer the center of political influence that it had been a few centuries earlier, but it was still very influential in areas of culture, the Greek culture, and in philosophy. I'm by no means an expert on the schools of philosophy in ancient Greece, but Luke identifies two particular groups, the Epicureans and the Stoics. So since those are the primary groups to whom Paul will be speaking, I think it makes a little bit of sense that we learn just a little bit about them and their beliefs. So I'm basing my descriptions primarily on a brief overview given by F.F. Bruce in his commentary on the book of Acts. The Stoics were founded by a fellow named Zeno, who lived from 340 to 265 B.C. Bruce says that he placed great emphasis on the primacy of the rational faculty in humanity and on individual self-sufficiency. In other words, man could take care of himself. All the answers to world problems could be found in the rational faculty of man. They were also a pantheistic group, meaning that they believed that there was something of God in everything. The Epicureans were the philosophical descendants of Epicurus, who lived about the same time as Zeno, there toward the turn of the 4th century into the 3rd century B.C. For Epicureans, the purpose of life was enjoy it, pleasure. The greatest pleasure was understood to be a life of tranquility, free of pain, disturbing passions, superstitious fears, including in particular the fear of death. In other words, the goal of life was to feel good about yourself. For Epicureans, if gods existed, they took no interest in the daily lives of humans. It's fairly easy to see that we can find both Stoic and Epicurean lines of thought in our modern world. We want comfort above all else. We even claim that we deserve to be comfortable. Have you ever noticed how often the word deserve is used, and we don't deserve anything, at least not the things we claim we deserve? And modern man certainly has a great confidence in man's abilities to solve man's problems with no divine assistance. So things come down through history pretty much the same. Those are the people to whom Paul preached in Acts chapter 17. Overall, there would have been little reason to expect much from an audience from this audience in relation to Christianity. It would not have been normal to really expect a whole lot out of them. Athenian thought would not have considered Christianity to be an option for the enlightened, reasonable people they consider themselves to be. Christianity would have been a quaint Eastern Mediterranean superstition. The term babbler that they used to describe Paul reveals this attitude in verse 18. Then certain Epicurean and Stoic philosophers encountered him, and some said, "What does this babbler want to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a proclaimer of foreign gods because he preached to them Jesus and the resurrection." The term babbler was not a term of mere condescendence. It was definitely that, but it was more a term of derision. It indicated someone of lesser intelligence, lesser culture, and less sophistication than they. Nevertheless, Paul accepted the invitation from this group for a formal audience before the philosophical leaders of the town. So we're going to take a look at Paul's presentation. First, we'll look at the subjects that he presented. But my main purpose is to look more at Paul's attitude, Paul's mindset in this presentation. In this case, Paul's approach to his message is maybe as important as the message itself. Maybe not for them, but for us at least. He opens with what we might call a soft approach, verses 22 and 23. Then Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are very religious. For as I was passing through and considering the objects of your worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' Therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing him, I proclaim to you." We often point out here that Paul started by finding common ground with his audience, and I have no argument with that. He noted that they were religious people, as evidenced by the large number of idols and altars and temples to be found in the city of first century Athens. They even had this altar to an unknown god. Now, I've heard different explanations of that labeling of that particular idol. An altar to an unknown god could simply be a superstitious precaution. They had altars to all the gods they knew of, but for fear of missing one and offending him, they had the unknown god altar, just, you know, covering all the bases. And that's a possibility. Won't rule it out. But a different explanation is that this was simply an old, really old altar. In fact, it was so old they had forgotten which god it was to. Maybe an earlier inscription was damaged and worn so that they couldn't even read any longer who this idol was dedicated to. So they labeled it to an unknown god. In either case, really doesn't make a whole lot of difference. In either case, they either had great reverence for their gods or reverence for their traditions and didn't want to violate either one. But it gave Paul a starting point. But we should not immediately conclude that Paul's statement was a compliment when he says, "You are very religious people." Just being religious is not always a good thing. If a missionary today found himself in a very polytheistic culture, he might recognize that the people were very religious, but not necessarily in a good way. So that's another, something to keep in mind. He was not necessarily patting them on their back for their religiosity. To give a more balanced understanding of Paul's thinking, let's go to Romans chapter 1 for just a moment. In Romans 1, Paul is describing people much like the Athenians. Doesn't Romans 1, verses 22 and 23 that we're going to read sound like the idolatrous philosophers of Athens? Romans 1, 22 and 23. "Professing to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image more made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things." If any population group thought they were wise, it was the Athenians. And if any place had changed the glory of God into images, it was Athens. Romans 1 seems to be describing Athens, or at least something like it. What we see here is Paul adapting to the purpose of his presentation. In Romans, he is writing to Christians to emphasize the sinfulness of man, that all are sinners. The description of idolaters in Romans 1 portrays their need for salvation and their need for God's grace. The readers of Romans 1 were people who knew and respected the story of Jesus already. He's writing to Christians just to reinforce some of their beliefs. The purpose and the audience of Acts 17 are different. Here, he wanted these people to listen to his message about a God they didn't know. So he finds what might have looked like common ground and started there. He takes a gentler approach than in Romans 1. And if you read the whole chapter 1 of Romans, you know that there's not a real gentle approach when describing idolaters, but he takes a gentler approach than he does in Romans 1. But eventually he's going to cover some of the same material and some of the same ideas. Now, as any good preacher will do, Paul's sermon had three main points. He does that in Athens. His first point is about the one God of creation. So he's not simply describing the unknown God. He isn't filling in this little gap in their pantheon. He isn't revealing the identity of this God whose identity they had forgotten. He is presenting the God who superseded every God that had an idol in the city. This wasn't just an unknown God. This is God who made the world and everything in it. Much like what we talked about in our sermon this morning. It would have been a bit different to present some minor deity that they had overlooked. But to suggest that they had overlooked the most supreme of all the gods would have been hard to swallow for the people of Athens. Especially since many of them didn't take any of the gods all that seriously. The God of Paul was so great that he created everything that exists, and he could not be contained even in the most grandiose of their magnificent temples. Obviously, with a pagan audience, It wouldn't have done much good for Paul to quote from the Old Testament. They didn't know, didn't believe, and didn't care about the sacred book of the Jews. But Paul's ideas in this sermon are straight out of Genesis, even if he doesn't actually quote the source. Paul is preaching Bible here to the pagans of Athens. Second point, this great God has made all people out of a single original bloodline. I don't know much about what the people of first century Athens thought about human origins, but I doubt that it looked a whole lot like Genesis chapter 1. Paul's God was the creator of everyone and everything that lived. He had created humans with the intention that they would have a real relationship with him. This is the same thought as once again we find over in Romans, the first chapter, but here with a different perspective. In Romans 1, verses 19 and 20, it says, "Because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse." And down in verse 25, "They who exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator who is blessed forever. Amen." Some of his hearers believed that God was in everything. Paul said that God made everything. Now, it may sound similar in some ways, but fundamentally and radically different realities, and realities that called for a much different response from mankind. He goes on to affirm that God is not an object or matter. God is a divine spiritual being. He is who he is, not what man wants to make of him. And whether or not some people in the audience were inclined to take Paul seriously, those ideas did not fit in with the normal Athenian worldview. Not at all. Then the third point really rocked the boat. God is going to judge mankind by a man who rose from the dead. If you check the different sermons through the book of Acts, and there are several of them, resurrection is always a central theme. It doesn't matter if the sermon is addressed to a Jewish audience or to Gentiles, as in Athens. He may approach it somewhat differently, but somewhere resurrection is presented. And the main focus is on the resurrection of Jesus. But there's also the implication that if Jesus rose, we can too. In this sermon, in Acts 17, it was Paul's mention of the resurrection that brought the sermon to a screeching halt. They had listened to the one supreme God part. They had listened to the God of creation part. But when he added the resurrection, they had had enough. Now let's look at the reaction of the audience at that point. Reading again what was read earlier in verses 32 through 34, we're back in Acts chapter 17. "And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, while others said, 'We will hear you again on this matter.' So Paul departed from among them. However, some men joined him and believed, among them Dionysius the Areopagite, a woman named Damaris, and others with them." Basically, we see three different reactions. Reaction number one, some mocked. In other words, they made fun of Paul. Resurrection was not part of their concept of life and the afterlife. Belief in a resurrection was actually sort of silly for them. We know that when Paul preached Christ crucified, that included in his mind also Christ resurrected. Paul's crucified Christ never stayed dead. So when he summarized Gentile reaction in general to the crucified Christ over in 1 Corinthians, therefore a letter written to the people in Corinth in 1 Corinthians 1:23, How does he describe it? To the Greeks, it's foolishness. Do you think maybe that when he wrote 1 Corinthians, he might have remembered his sermon in the nearby city of Athens when people mocked the idea of the resurrection? Reaction number two, some people said, "We will hear from you again on this matter." And I can see two ways of understanding this statement. Some folks may have sincerely wanted to think about it, what they had heard, and hear more after they had given it some thought. Or maybe some were just kinder than the ones who mocked him. Sort of, give the poor bumpkin a break. It's like when you tell the salesman that you'll think about it. You're not going to think about it. You're not going to buy it, but you want to send him away gently. That could well have been their response there of that second group. We'll hear from you again sometime on this. Reaction number three. Some men joined him and believed, plus some women. We have to assume that these represented a tiny minority of the audience. The best that we can say is that the others weren't violent and hostile as they had been up in Thessalonica. They just laughed. And then there were these who were more interested. All of that, up until this point now, all of that is background. That's the introduction. Now we have the lesson, and the lesson is really short. The introduction is huge. What we really want to talk about now is Paul. We have three reactions to his message, of which two are negative. One really negative and one probably more negative than anything else. One of them is blatant ridicule, and the second might be ridicule of a more gentle form. Only the third group, and probably the smallest group by far, took Paul seriously. None of that was a surprise to Paul. When Paul chose his three points, one supreme God, all mankind of one origin, and a resurrected Savior and Judge, he knew that ridicule was coming. That was not a surprise. It was expected. This was not out of the reasonable realm of expectations for an audience who believed what he knew in advance his audience believed. Remember, this speech is a culmination of several days of conversations with the same people. So he already knew what they thought. He knew before he started that at best, only a few would take him seriously. He knew before he started that if he wanted to avoid ridicule, he needed to talk about something else. But he talked about one supreme God, a God who created man, and a destination of judgment and resurrection. Isn't it interesting that those same three topics will often receive the same responses today? Folks in Athens believed in many gods. Today the tendency is to believe in no God, but to affirm a supreme God who created all that is will be mocked in many circles. The affirmation that all men are descended from one man by an act of God is also going to be received with ridicule by many in our world. As will any teaching about judgment. Heaven, hell, eternal accountability after a general resurrection only works in certain very specific religious environments. To what extent is Luke's account in Acts 17 a summary of what Paul actually said is uncertain. Was this the full text of all that he said? If not, how much more did he say, of which this is only a main point summary or outline? I don't know. But in the account that we have, Paul doesn't even try to prove what he says. He merely said, "This is the God I serve." And the response was up to them. And in that, we find our example. Paul knew that he would be laughed at, either openly or behind his back. but he stated what he believed anyway. If he had not been willing to accept the ridicule and the rejection, Dionysius, Damaris, and the others would not have heard the gospel. I leave it there for your consideration. If you have not responded to the gospel, which is laughed at by many but is the only road to eternal salvation, we encourage you to do that this evening. If we can help you in your walk with God, let us know. Let's stand and let's sing.